Hello, my name is Jimmy Packham. I'm a lecturer here in English literature at the University of Birmingham. My research specialisms include Gothic literature and the literature of the sea. And what I'd like to talk to you today about is something that brings these two research interests together, thinking about the literary and cultural history of our coastlines, particularly Britain's coastlines. And I want to suggest that we continuously imagine this space, these shoreline spaces, as haunted. And this idea of our haunted shorelines has a long and fascinating history that speaks to important ways that we have invested the British shoreline with real symbolic importance, that speaks to questions around nationhood, national identity, and senses of belonging. And so by adopting a perspective that imagines the coast, the shoreline, the beach, not as somehow the edges of the nation, the limit of the nation, the point at which the nation might be seen to end, but rather by imagining the coastline as the centre of a cultural and literary tradition, we can see the important ways in which it has shaped our literature, and conversely, the way in which the literature that we read has helped to shape the way we imagine this space. And more importantly, I think, we can see how this idea has taken on particular urgency in recent years, even as I hope to suggest, it has quite a long history. So let's begin with some of that history. We can trace this tradition back to a book that is often considered the first novel in English, Daniel Defoe's Robinson Crusoe from 1719. This is the story of a man shipwrecked and forced to live on what at first seems to be an uninhabited tropical island, spending the majority of his time traversing the shoreline. Two things come to light here. First, we see that the coast and the emergence of a very particular literary tradition, the realist novel, go hand in hand. Second, we also see that the novel explores with quite striking detail the prospect of a specifically haunted shoreline and what that means, what an encounter at that space means for the identity of someone like Robinson Crusoe. So partway through the story, Crusoe has established a pretty functional domestic setup on his island. It is often seen to be a kind of microcosm for society or for civilization, for the development of nationhood. Other people have read the book as a commentary on British imperialism. But everything begins to fall apart for him when, in a very famous sequence in this book, he encounters a strange single footprint on the beach near his home. "I stood like one thunderstruck," Crusoe tells us, "or as if I had seen an apparition." He runs home and he tells us he's terrified to the last degree. It's quite interesting, I think, that at this moment in the story, Crusoe quite explicitly tells us he begins to call that home his castle. "For so," he says, "I think I called it ever after this." I'll come back to that in a second. Now, as far as Crusoe knows, he is alone on this island, and he begins to wonder if the devil has come for him. He then wonders if cannibals from neighbouring lands have crossed the waters and landed on his shore. How funny, he begins to think for himself, that having previously thought that finding another human being on this island would have been the greatest blessing that heaven could have given him, how funny that now he would be, as he says, ready to sink into the ground at but the shadow or silent appearance of a man's having set his foot in the island. Crusoe then spends 2 years absolutely terrified of encountering someone else, encountering whoever left this footprint. He is terrified about what it means. He even moves his entire home, his entire kind of mini estate, in order to feel safer. It is a wonderfully evocative moment in the book. So the language of haunting and spectrality that Crusoe jumps to as soon as he sees this footprint is very telling, I think. Crusoe begins to populate his shoreline with all manner of threatening and frightening others, beginning with the ghostly. He talks about thinking he might see an apparition, and then with the devil and the demonic, before he begins to turn to more tangible human others, the apparent cannibals of whom he lives in terror. Now, whether or not the figure who left that footprint is real or ghostly, I think that's less important than what matters is the fact that they are absent now, and that all that remains of them is this strange, eerie imprint of their presence. As a result, they are rendered spectral. It's a presence that Crusoe can only infer or imagine, and he begins to imagine himself and his shoreline as haunted. And this turns his world upside down. Everything changes from here on in this book. The secure home he thought he had no longer seems so secure to him. The shore becomes a point of entry into his world, a point of incursion from potentially hostile forces. In some ways, Robinson Crusoe should know this. He is, after all, a castaway, having been washed ashore himself several years earlier. It is not beyond the bounds of possibility that someone else might experience this as well, and that this might change the social structure of Crusoe's island. In fact, one of the things this novel might prompt us to think about, even today in the 21st century, is what Crusoe, himself a former castaway, might owe to someone who has been washed ashore on part of a land that Crusoe himself has claimed. So what kind of duties might Crusoe owe to someone he finds washed up on the beach here? And we are perhaps not so far here from thinking about similar real-world duties that we might owe towards those arriving on our shorelines. Either way, the small world, the little nation of which Crusoe has imagined himself the sole citizen and overlord, is threatened from without, and it's the intangibility of that threat, the fact that this threat remains unknown, that really unsettles him. And the shore becomes the ideal space in which to dramatize these kinds of anxieties, this kind of existential crisis that Robinson Crusoe undergoes, which is also, I think, a crisis of belonging, a crisis of community, of not quite feeling at home anymore. The absent figure's presence becomes known to us through the soft imprint of a foot on the sand. The beach retains, as it were, the ghost of this figure. And even the way that Crusoe begins to imagine his relationship to his home, the building in which he lives, has changed. As I mentioned, from this point on, he starts to refer to this home as his castle. And that old saying that an Englishman's home is his castle doesn't seem so far away from us at this point. And this is apt, I think. You know, it's an entirely sensible saying to think through because it begins to speak to the way in which Crusoe seeks not just to reimagine the security of his home, of this domestic space, but to imagine the control and the authority that he exerts there as well. He is the lord of this so-called castle, of this space. Or at least so he tries to tell himself. But as the shoreline reminds us here, this idea of control, this idea of feeling secure, is perhaps very fragile, is perhaps nothing more than an illusion that he has conjured up. So the issues that this particular sequence from Defoe's novel raises include questions about how one is meant to live alongside others, how one's identity is inflected by the presence of others, about how one's sense of self, how one's sense of one's homeland, as it were, might be reshaped by a haunting encounter at the shoreline, at the limits of that homeland. So I think Robinson Crusoe gives us a really evocative starting point for thinking about a British shoreline tradition in literature and culture. But let's jump forward a bit now to more recent years to consider why thinking about shorelines matters now. I don't think anyone will need to cast their minds back very far to see how important coasts and coastal waters have been to various fraught political conversations around Britain, around national identities and communities, around the nebulous question of sovereignty, a word that I'm sure all of us have heard 1,000 times in recent years. You may remember, for instance, that in summer 2020, not long after the first wave of the coronavirus pandemic, various media outlets frothed in fury over images of overpopulated beaches in coverage of the seeming transgression of various lockdown restrictions. In the following months, the beach occupied a conspicuous position in studies of transmissibility. It turns out that actually perhaps the beach wasn't, after all, such a problematic hotspot of infection. It was outside, the air circulated freely. But what matters, I think, is the conspicuous presence of the beach itself as a space of highly visible, seemingly transgressive, or at least perhaps morally irresponsible behaviour. We might also think about how fishing in coastal waters has remained an area of long-standing tension between Britain and the European Union. This is an issue that speaks to questions around national sovereignty via the prospect of exerting control over coastal zones, over what are often termed our coastal zones. As the rhetoric of the Leave campaign during the Brexit referendum spoke, for instance, of taking back control of our waters, of our fishing industry. And so again, we have a coastal space conspicuous for being something potentially out of control, out of our control. You may also recall, more recently from May 2021, when rather absurdly Royal Navy vessels were dispatched to Jersey over a brief spat between British and French fishing trawlers. And to keep thinking about that recent referendum around EU membership, many of us might remember how visual and rhetorical references to the coast have exploited the symbolic richness of this space in order to speak to fears around migration. A poster released in 2014 by UKIP, the UK Independence Party, during the Brexit referendum featured an image of an escalator running up the White Cliffs of Dover, those iconic images of a kind of Englishness. And what this image did, while on the one hand figuring the coast as an image of the kind of geographical limit of the nation, also suggested that this limit was largely and perhaps unnervingly an unbounded point of entry. It was an image designed to tap into a cultural imaginary that might latch onto the prospect of the fragility or precarity of that which is supposed to be firm and fixed. Borders and boundaries. Finally, we might think as well of coasts as rich spaces ecologically and as rich social spaces as well that are under threat in various ways from climate change. As we confront a future whose sea levels remain in flux, our coasts and shorelines may themselves assume dramatically different forms. As a result of sea level rises, there is also a kind of inherent instability in coastal spaces with the movement of the tides, with the effect of the sea on the land. They are assuming ever so subtly different shapes and aspects every day. It's sometimes strange, I think, for those of us who work on these spaces to think that the particular coasts that we might be talking about today may not exist, may not be visible to us in quite the same way in a couple of years' time. This sort of erosion is generally happening very, very slowly, the gradual erasure of the edges of the nation, but can sometimes happen with sort of dramatic rapidity. Will all of us, I'm sure, have seen media reports of the sudden collapsing of cliff faces into the sea, usually accompanied by a picture of a house now teetering gently on the newly formed precipice. So this again gives us an opportunity to think about control or lack of it, perhaps in slightly less overtly political ways, but certainly in ways of social and environmental significance. Now, these are not new issues by any stretch of the imagination. The British Isles are islands. And the history of Great Britain or the United Kingdom is an archipelagic history. It's a history of encounters between island states and island nations. And everyone, I'm sure, will be able to bring to mind particular aspects of British or English or Scottish or Irish or Welsh history that speak specifically to the coast in important ways, the way in which those spaces have functioned in important ways. But for many of us, I think it may feel especially so that the coast has been at the heart of much that is of current urgent political or cultural interest. And so what I'd like to do for the remainder of this talk is just think about the ways in which, by turning to literature, we can start to grapple in more detail with those debates and those questions that underpin many of the topics I've just touched on. So, above all, perhaps, and it's perhaps, you know, we don't want to forget this, for many of us, for most of us, the beach is a site of pleasurable recreation. We go on beach holidays. We may all have seen the insidious adverts on public transport that ask us whether or not we are beach body ready. Since the rise of the beach as a holiday destination in the 18th century, and that's something that really took off over the 19th century and through the Victorian period, since then the British have flocked to the coast. The fashion of beach resorts and the dramatic rise in small coastal spa towns is something that an author like Jane Austen offers a wonderful satire on in her unfinished novel, Sanditon. It was a novel she started in 1817, the year that she died. As one of the characters in that book says, Mr. Hayward, after being told that this new town, Sanditon, is being built on the south coast of England, he says, every 5 years, one hears of some new place or other starting up by the sea and growing the fashion. How they can half of them be filled is the wonder. So this is the silly, sunny side to the shore. And historians suggest that it's between about 1750 and 1840 that the coast begins to enter the British cultural imagination in this way, in ways that are still important and familiar to us today as a site of pleasure and holidaying and recreation. But what stands out to me about that time period, 1750 to 1840, is that this is almost exactly coextensive with the emergence and the heyday of Gothic literature as well, which is usually identified as emerging in 1764 and running in its first instance to about 1820. It emerges with a book called The Castle of Otranto by Horace Walpole, the son of Robert Walpole, Britain's first Prime Minister. For lots of us, this tradition, this Gothic tradition, signifies, I think, very clearly a certain set of particular images and tropes and clichés. Whether or not we grew up reading books like Frankenstein or Dracula, or grew up watching the adaptations of those books by movie studios like Universal or Hammer Horror, the Gothic is a genre of spooky castles, of crumbling ruined abbeys, of hidden tunnels, of tyrannical lords and aristocrats, of swooning young maidens, of monsters and vampires and ghosts, and so on. But I want you to reimagine this tradition. Not the genre of castles or frightening foreign lands, but as a coastal genre. A genre particularly in the British tradition, defined by its preoccupation with coastlines, with people dwelling on the coast, with things turning up unexpectedly on the shore. And so it's a genre that is preoccupied above all with our haunted history of the coast. It is easy to imagine, I think, why the treacherous terrain of a storm-tossed coast lashed by waves and littered with the detritus of shipwreck, onto which there is always the risk of things being washed up that we would rather remained hidden, submerged, and out of sight. Why that should appeal to writers of the Gothic. The coast, as the Gothic imagines it, tests the limits of the self. It exposes the individual to hostile and potentially fatal forces in a volatile environment to the foreign or alien beings that turn up on those shores. Monstrous creatures roam these shorelines that become both symbolically and culturally an intersection of two very different worlds, the land and the sea, one of them known and familiar and perhaps comforting, the other unknown, unfamiliar, uninhabitable. In the wider cultural imagination, the coast is this funny, I think, in-between space in so many ways. People have a tendency to write about the coast in sort of abstract, nebulous ways. It's not quite land, it's not quite sea, it's somewhere in the middle. It's frequently a point of arrival or a point of departure, not a space many people dwell too long for. It's unstable, it's constantly shifting. It is a liminal space. Thinking about the historical origins of the genre of the Gothic as well, so back to its emergence, I don't think it's any coincidence that the Gothic emerges as a genre preoccupied with liminal coastal spaces, because it's a genre also emerging around the time of the French Revolution. The Gothic has often been understood to be a kind of response by English or British writers to the horrors and terror of the French Revolution. The Gothic offers meditations on different kinds of terror. The fear then that the revolution might cross the channel from France to Britain underpins, I think, the Gothic's early adoption of the coast as a significant geography. It matters in classic early novels by a writer like Anne Radcliffe, and it comes back to us very explicitly in a later work that directly reflects on the French Revolution arriving on British shores, a novel called The Wanderer by Fanny Burney from 1814. This Gothic mystery novel begins with a group of people fleeing the terror in France on a small boat headed for England, carrying with them a passenger whose identity and origins no one can quite identify. And that frisson of uncertainty drives much of the narrative. The prospect that foreign threats might land on British coasts underpins a book as famous as Dracula, as well as other readers of this novel have noted. This is basically a book about Dracula, about this famous vampire sailing to England. And he arrives on what becomes something like a ghost ship that drifts eerily into Whitby Harbour, arriving, as others have suggested, to colonise the imperial nation that was Britain at the end of the 19th century. And some of the most evocative passages of that book reflect both on the horror of that sea voyage, but also reflect on England's coastlines and the histories of those who have lived and died there, and those who have lived and died at sea as well, and the ways in which having a coastal existence, how does one memorialise properly bodies that remain missing at sea or bodies that have been washed away from the coastline? So that's a sort of whistle-stop tour, I suppose, of some of the ways in which a haunted coast figures in some of the most famous books of Gothic writing. Coming back to the present then, we can see how this aspect of Gothic writing is really flourishing at the moment. We've had an absolute abundance of books by Gothic writers in Britain exploring our haunted shores in the last couple of years. So many, in fact, that it's actually getting quite difficult to keep up with how many are being published. In 2009, Helen Oyeyemi published a book called White is for Witching. This is a book set in a haunted house on the White Cliffs of Dover. And more recently, we've had books by writers including Andrew Michael Hurley, Well Menmuir, Daisy Johnson, Jen Ashworth, Lucy Wood, Evie Wilde, Emma Stonex, all of them exploring different facets of a haunted coastline. And what I think unites these books is not just that exploration of a particular part of the coastlines of the British Isles, but that they also ask the same question in different ways. They ask, who does and who does not belong at the coast? And by extension, who belongs on the shores of the nation? As such, they explore national and local communities. They explore important and pressing questions about belonging. To take that first example, White is for Witching by Helen Oyeyemi, this book offers an especially striking engagement with that iconic symbol of English nationhood, setting its haunted and strangely sentient guest house at the heart of the story in Dover by those white cliffs. That whiteness of those cliffs matters in this novel. The story is largely concerned with issues of immigration and xenophobia, but also of what it means to be black British, to be a young black British girl in particular, in contemporary Britain. And this house, this haunted sentient guest house, is a kind of figure of racism. The house itself is racist. It haunts and horrifies and terrifies all of the people of colour who come to work or stay inside it, including one of the protagonists, a girl called Ore, who is British with Nigerian heritage. And that, so the house and the iconic whiteness of its location becomes a lens through which to reflect on contemporary racism. Late in the novel, the British National Party are seen leafleting in nearby Faversham. And another strand of the novel concerns the treatment endured by people at a so-called immigrant removal centre. But it's in the landscape, I think, that the novel begins to do its most compelling and its most suggestive work. At one point in the story, the setting is described like this. Across the cliffs, Dover Castle was black. The sun was rising and the sea was changing colour, but the castle stayed within its lines, hunched in a black mass of shapes. And the vast bank of chalk it stood on seemed to stir in the water, as if fighting the darkness that tried to climb down it. At a later point, in the dark again, the cliffs are seen covered in snow, and we're told that the cliffs were wearing broad chains of snow. At moments like this, the narrative imagines the landscape itself as somehow resisting this quasi-Gothic blackness, the hunched black mess of shapes. And conversely, from the perspective of one of the novel's protagonists, one of its central characters, that whiteness overlaying the landscape, imagined as broad chains, has implications in it, I think, of confinement, of one's freedoms being restricted by those broad chains of imposing whiteness. It's an idea echoed, for instance, by those BNP leafleteers we see elsewhere in the novel, while also subtly, but intentionally and meaningfully, invoking England's own colonial past and broad chains of enslavement. So that's one example, I think, of the work that the coast is doing in contemporary writing and the issues that it's urging us to think through. A more recent example of exploring national histories and identities at the coast can be found in Andrew Michael Hurley's 2014 novel, The Loney. In this novel, the coast, in this instance, we're on the northwest coast of England in a fictional version of Morecambe Bay, referred to in the book as The Loney. In this book, the coast is eerie through and through. It seems to watch the group of Londoners who pilgrimage to this space each year. It seems weirdly alive. It seems sentient, again, and the isolated and somewhat hostile local people of this space have oddly magical powers. They seem able, for instance, to restore wounded bodies back to full health. And alongside this kind of fantastical supernatural element, the Loney is haunted by real-world horrors as well, including the drowning in 2004 of a group of Chinese immigrant labourers, cockle pickers, in Morecambe Bay. And it's a tragedy that's directly evoked in the novel. There are so many strange and unsettling encounters at the shore in this book that I could turn to almost any page of it to find a good example for you. But I'm just going to focus on one. One of the main sites of interest in this book is an old pillbox, a wartime fortification, located on the beach and left to weather the elements. The two young boys at the heart of this story take to the pillbox and they play soldiers there. They note that this pillbox has been decorated with swastikas and with National Front graffiti. They imagine themselves in quite explicitly and heightened racist and xenophobic language as defeating imaginary German and Japanese soldiers. They recreate around this pillbox various battles of the Second World War, including those battles like the Battle of Arnhem, in which the Allied forces were not victorious, though the boys imagine they are. What we see here then, in a moment like this, in this imaginary play around this relic from the Second World War, is that these boys begin to act out nationalist ideologies of British military supremacy in a coastal fortification, the pillbox, which itself exists as a kind of index of the threat of foreign invasion. And because it's also covered in swastikas and National Front graffiti, it also stands as a site of nationalist attention as well. This pillbox remains a relic of a war-torn past whose narrative, whose history, whose reverberations persist into the present. In the physical form of that pillbox, the pillbox is a physical reminder of the war, but also in the imaginations of the boys themselves, who reprise and act out and reiterate a racist and xenophobic portrayal of a foreign other. So these boys and the coastal games that they're playing seek to sustain a vision of British military and national and cultural supremacy, in which the British forces, as they say, win every time, despite the historical facts. With some irony, I think, at the end of this episode in the book, we are finally told that this region, the Loney, was just a place the Luftwaffe passed over on their way to the Clyde. And the Third Reich never did come marauding up the Irish Sea in the end. So the pillbox, after all, stands as an odd monument to a historical reality that never materialised. Another suggestive kind of spectrality, I think. War never came to the Loney, except in the war games played by the children, who turn to the coast and to the world it points to across the seas, the world beyond Britain, in order to stake a claim on the nostalgic visions of a powerful British past. So that's just two examples from recent fiction. But what I want to use those to suggest, and it's something I think we see borne out across a host of recent Gothic shoreline publications, is that these books represent coastal spaces in order to speak overtly to contemporary preoccupations with the porousness and instability of supposedly fixed and firm borders and identities. The Gothic is a participant here in a broader debate around the symbolic power of the British coastline, and it explores this region in order to interrogate the relationship between individuals, their local environment, their homeland, and its traditions. This is a fiction, then, that resonates with contemporary debates about British identity, about the prospect of no longer belonging to a particular space, to a particular place, speaking to divisions within British communities as much as the problems of belonging to a wider international community. These stories illustrate the ongoing conflicts that shape coastal existence or coastal coexistence and citizenship more broadly in 21st century Britain. But it's not all doom and gloom. The Gothic engages these histories to help us think beyond them, to rethink the forms of relation between people and communities, even if the novels themselves don't always or often or ever posit happy endings or resolutions. By paying careful, critical attention to what it is they have to say, we can engage with the fraught ideological work undertaken by the coasts in our cultural imaginary. But Gothic, I think, is often a very generous genre. Yes, it wants to terrify us and horrify us, but it wants us also, I think, to think about the ethics of our engagement with that which is horrific or unsettling or unpleasant to us. And by bombarding us with ghosts and spectres and the like, again and again, the Gothic urges its protagonists and its readers to try to meaningfully understand them, to try to meaningfully engage with them. And within that Gothic world, it is, in particular, the strange ecology of the coast that becomes an evocative way to start rethinking our connection to things, our senses of belonging in the world or to the world. In the language of ecology, the coast represents what is called an ecotone. An ecotone is an overlapping of two distinct ecologies, and it generates a third ecology in the middle of that overlap. As the editors of the volume called Coastal Works have recently said, ecotones often produce an abundance of life and exhibit an intensification of activity across that overlapping border zone. So the coast here is a hotbed of processes of life, of transformation, of imagining life sustained across two different worlds, the terrestrial and the oceanic. And the Gothic asks us, the human, to take a similar plunge, to entertain the idea of existing between spaces, of remaking our forms of connection. So an evocative final example can be found at the end of Daisy Johnson's supernatural short story collection, Fen. The coast in this volume is the coast of the Fenlands in East Anglia, the coastal Fenlands of East Anglia. And the last story of this collection is about a female lighthouse keeper who is consistently excluded and derided by the largely male community around her. And she turns to the coastal waters for solace, and perhaps, losing her mind slightly, begins to find new company with a fish that seems to swim around the lighthouse around her. She wonders what this fish knows. She wonders what this fish might want to communicate with her, if it wants to communicate with her. We are told that this lighthouse keeper yells her knowledge of the creature out into the cold foam. She is struck by the way that it could have stung her and did not, the way it moved with an almost human intelligence. Not a food source or a pretty thing to watch, but maybe a friend, she says. And what we can see here is that the fish makes visible to this character and to us alternative conditions of being and knowledge. The fish's complete indifference to the human world causes the lighthouse keeper to reflect not on a kind of alarming otherness, but to undertake a curious pursuit of community. That means she comes to reject the coast as a site of human community and industry, and dives instead into a realm populated by creatures with what the lighthouse keeper has termed an almost human intelligence. And I think it's important that that intelligence is almost human, recognizably human, connecting to the human, but fundamentally not human. The tale then becomes a celebration of the selfhood of the other, a celebration of the otherness of difference. By the end of the story, she is taking the plunge into the fish's world. She dives into the water by the lighthouse. And the narrative tells us she lost light all the way down until it was dark enough only to feel the motion of something brushing against her leg. The lighthouse keeper swims until it is so dark that sight is impossible, until she can only feel motion and material being. It's a movement into a world of obscure flux and fluidity, an effort to embrace the transformative potential and renewed kinds of community and communion that are offered up in this curious and haunting region. Thank you.